Good morning and welcome to November. Our mission statement says that we're here to turn out young people who are tireless workers and know how to work effectively. In November, we will focus on what it means to be an effective worker. From my point of view, there are many characteristics that you could point out about effective workers. That could be someone who comes prepared to class so that they're ready to engage in the material. It could be submitting your work on time. It could be participation. It could be somebody who has self-discipline, who avoids distractions, who works well with others, and the list goes on and on. But from a greater overview, when you know how to work effectively, you learn to work smarter. Truly, I see tireless work and effective work is going hand in hand. Today's reading is about being an effective worker. It comes from the Bhagavad Gita. It's a 700-verse Hindu scripture, which is part of an epic Mahabharata. The Bhagavad Gita is a commentary by Lord Krishna to the warrior prince Arjuna on the battlefield. So from the Bhagavad Gita, chapter 2, verse 47, "To action alone hast thou a right, and never at all to its fruits. Let not the fruits of the action be thy motive, neither let there be in thee attachment to inaction. There is no substitute for hard work, and eventually your hard work will pay off." Here we learn the valuable lesson of letting go of the results and not allowing that to dictate our attitude towards the work. Don't let the results become the focal point, as they can turn into a distraction. Instead, focus on the work itself and what you learned through hard work and the formation of good work habits. This is how we become effective workers. This morning we have three junior presenters: Macy Simon from Shelbyville, Tennessee, Bob Yan from Beijing, China, and A.D. Norse from Manchester, Tennessee. Good luck.
Hi, my name is Macy Simon, and for my junior project, I sewed a dress I could wear to strings concerts and a skirt I could wear to school. So I chose sewing because I knew my Mimi could teach me and I could spend time with her. Just the idea of sewing sounded fun to me, and it's a useful skill. So here are the materials that I used for this project, but primarily for the skirt and the dress, I needed patterns, fabric, thread, and of course, a sewing machine. So to start the skirt, I first had to cut out the pattern and then pin that pattern to my fabric and then cut out the fabric. So here, out of these individual four pieces, I sewed around the edges to prevent the skirt from unraveling. And then I sewed the front two pieces and the back two pieces of the skirt together. So here I ran into my first major challenge, and that was when my Mimi and I realized the skirt was going to be too big. This is because the sizing of the skirt pattern was different than a sizing that you'd buy at a store. So after talking with her for about an hour on how to solve this problem, she had the idea of going back to the original pattern, and now that I had a better idea of what size I was, I measured the waist of that size for all four of the parts, and then added those together to see if it about equaled to the size of my waist. And this ended up working really well, and I wish I would have started with this first because it would have saved a lot of time. But I learned from it, and going forward with the dress, I used this method first. And so I ended up having to recut the skirt roughly around the red lines and having to do the first steps over again. So the final steps of the skirt was to sew on my waistband and then to hand stitch the hook and eye to clasp the skirt together. And then here's a picture of the final skirt. You might see me wearing it around campus today. So to start the dress, I had to pick out a pattern and then I cut out all the fabric. And then on the right, you can see the top of the dress. And then in this video, I'm going to baste the shoulders And so basting is a stitch that's loose, so you're able to take it out. So I could try it on and then adjust it if necessary. And then to work the sewing machine, I had to put down the needle and then drop the zipper foot, which is the metal piece to hold the fabric down. And then I use the pedal at the bottom to make the sewing machine go. And here I'm sewing down the side of the dress. So after this, I put in the invisible zipper in the back of the dress. And then here's what the dress looks like so far without the sleeves. And so I contemplated just leaving it like this because I liked how the dress looked so much. But I really wanted the experience of putting in the pleats on the sleeve, which you can see in the right picture. And so I already pinned where the pleats would go. So after that, I would baste the pleats in, then attach the sleeve, and then I would take the basting out so that the sleeve would be more full. So the challenges I faced with the dress were more minor detail oriented, which shows that I did improve from the skirt to the dress. And so first, as you can see in the biggest picture, I wanted the sleeve to hang less off my shoulder. And so to fix this, I just had to take the stitching out and redo it. And so this was a little harder because I didn't baste the stitch in. And so I had to use a seam ripper to cut the stitches and then pull and do this over again until the thread was out. And then when I re-sewed it together, I had to take a greater seam allowance to fix this problem. I also accidentally sewed in some creases, as you can see in the biggest picture and circled in the purple. And so for this, I just had to go back and redo it and just make sure the fabric wasn't gathering underneath. And so overall, this was a little tedious, but it improved my sewing and my abilities with the seam ripper. And so here's the final product. So here's the time that I spent on this project. Total, it took 42 hours. And as you can see, most of it was on the dress because that was the main goal. So I learned how to use a sewing machine and to make clothing from scratch. I also learned how to put in a zipper and pleats. I learned that there's a lot more to sewing than just sitting at a sewing machine and doing that. I had to cut out all my fabric, and then for everything that I sewed together, I had to pin that in first. I also learned to enjoy the process and appreciate along the way, especially when you're doing a long project, because it's essential to keep you motivated. And then I learned to be patient with myself because I was completely new at sewing and that it didn't have to be perfect. So I definitely have a greater appreciation for people who do this for a living and for my Mimi who did it when she was younger. And I'm happy that I got to learn how to do that with her and carry it on. And so I want to thank my Mimi for instructing me, Ms. Seals for keeping me accountable over the summer, Mr. Smith for viewing my slides, and all of you for listening.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Bob. This is my third year at lab, and for my junior project, I cook steak. There are a couple of reasons why I chose this project. So last summer, I traveled a lot, visiting my families in the state. And I first went to Texas, and then stayed with my uncle and my cousin in California for a month. So with all that in my head, when I was planning on this project, I was thinking something more skill-based, for I can take it with me everywhere I travel to. So cooking came up to me as a good idea. And since steak has long been my favorite food, I decided to learn how to cook it. So there actually have been several times before this project that I tried to cook steak. And the result were edible, but hardly satisfactory. So this time, I started off with some Google research, and I found thousands of YouTube videos with some instructions, but they all have their different methods, so I have to combine a few theories and form my own, which I'll talk about later. And ingredients are another big part. So I got all the ingredients I need from a grocery store called Safeway near my uncle's place, taking only a 20-minute walk. And there are several ways that you can cook a steak. You can put it in the oven, roasting it, and where you can take it outside and grill it. So the method I chose is stovetop searing, because I can have a better control of temperature, and the use of butter makes the steak more flavorful. And more importantly, searing takes much less time than the other two methods, which makes my project, my practice, significantly more effective. So the first step is seasoning. So as easy as it looks, took a steak off its package tray and they put salt and pepper on both sides of it. So at the beginning, I like to rinse the steak with tap water at first, but I stopped doing that as soon as I realized the steak has to be as dry as possible when you put it on the pan, searing it to not make the oil to splatter. And after the steak is well seasoned, here comes searing. So the method I developed over time is that I'll cook a steak for two times. The first time using only canola oil and high heat, and sear the steak for 1 minute per side. And then you put the steak aside and put butter, condiment, and turn it to medium heat and sear the steak for a second time for 2 to 5 minutes per side. So you probably notice that there's a huge time difference between the cooking time of the steak, and that is the biggest challenge I faced in this project. Because the cooking time of the steak varies greatly depending on the doneness you want it to be, and also the temperature before you cook it. So for example, it takes longer to cook a steak that you just took out from the fridge compared to one that has been placed in room temperature for a long time. So the solution I came up with is that I trained myself to test the doneness of the steak by pressing like a spatula on the steak while cooking. And it helps me a lot in my cooking process. And after I feel the steak is sufficiently seared, I'll leave it outside on the cutting board and let it hold for 10 minutes. So this step is actually important, but it has been neglected at first. So when you're searing the steak, the heat, the surface of the meat is heated up, leaving the center a little bit undercooked. So by holding the steak, you're giving time and letting the heat from the surface to flow in and cook the center, and it makes the steak more juicier. And throughout the month of July, as you can see in those pictures I showed, I start taking this project seriously and cooking intensively. And the total cooking time tallied to 22 hours, not counting the time that I spend shopping for ingredients and eating afterward. So with tons of practice and tiny bit of video editing skill, here's my product. Near the end, I'd like to talk about takeaways and some of my thoughts. So throughout this project, as the practice going on, cooking steak is no longer a hard thing for me, and my cooking skill got improved generally, which is one of my starting goals. And of course, there are challenges that I faced. There is the tediousness of of daily practice, daily cooking, and there's losing motivation in the midway. And of course, there's splattering butter. But what I really want to say is that it's the attitude that matters the most. So problems and challenges will pop up, and some of them you'll find that you have to struggle through. But with good attitude, you can come up, you may find the solution and work it out with an enjoyable process. And you can even make fun of it, bring some laughter to yourself and people around you. At the end, I'd like to give some big thank yous to my family for financially supporting me, my advisory for helping me out in this preparation, my cousin Gary for being the best photographer, and all of you for listening.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Adi Norris. This is my second year at Webb, and for my junior project, I learned to take narrative biographies, also known as oral histories. So I chose this project, number one, because of my family history. My family, for as long as I can remember, have always been farmers between Warren and Grundy County, and it recently occurred to me that I'm actually going to be the first generation in my family since the 1700s not to be a farmer between Warren and Grundy County. In that top right picture, you can see my four times great-grandfather Rock Martin's house. He was a plantation owner in the 1800s in Warren County. And farming has always been just a big part of my family, and I wanted to dive more into that and learn about that. Number two, I wanted to bond with my family. I haven't gotten to see my grandparents as much as I would have liked to since COVID happened. And I also moved further away from my family's nursery than I used to. So I wanted to go back and bond with my grandparents and learn more about them. Number three, because I've always had a love for visual storytelling, whether that be through my art or otherwise. And I wanted to create something that would explore my love for visual storytelling and I could go back to and look at years from now as, you know, an exploration of my grandparents and my family history. And number four, because I wanted to raise awareness for farmers and the farming industry as a whole. If you're unfamiliar with nurseries as a whole, it's basically a tree farm that grows trees to sell to commercial, like a tree seller, so that they can give them to businesses for landscaping purposes. So my steps, number one, I needed to gather my materials, and then I needed to learn how to use them. So I was a complete beginner at this. I had no idea really how to film anything. So I really needed to like learn how to use my materials effectively. I also needed to schedule and travel a time to meet with people and interview them. The scheduling proved to be pretty difficult because my grandparents are really busy with their nursery and their workers are also really busy. So I ended up having to go back multiple days just so that I could meet with everyone and have a lengthy interview with them. I also needed to film my interviews so that I could have a nice finished product where I could collect all of my interviews into a concise format to watch. And then editing and finishing the filming process, I needed to fit all of my interviews, which was hours and hours worth of footage, into a concise little over 4 minute video format. So here's me gathering my materials. I needed a Nikon camera, a Rode ambient microphone for capturing background audio, a tripod for holding my camera, a Rode directional mic for capturing interview audio, a Tascam audio recorder, which is basically just a device that captures all the audio files and stores them for later. And my editing software I used for finishing my product was called Wondershare Filmora, and it's a professional video editing software. And gathering my materials took about 3 hours. Filming, here's me filming all of my interviews. So this was definitely the most fun step in my whole project. I really, really enjoyed sitting down with my family and their employees and learning about them and getting to talk to them. You can see me interviewing my uncle in the top left there, and then interviewing my grandpa in the top right. And then there's me in the bottom left interviewing Francisco Garcia, who is our company's foreman. And then the bottom right is just me walking around the nursery. And that took about 20 hours. So the last step was editing. It was not my favorite part of the project. This took about 50 hours of just sitting and plugging away at it and cutting and editing over and over and over again. It was really tedious, but I ended up powering through it, and I'm really happy with how my final product turned out because I kept sticking with it. So here is my final product. I needed to fit about 4-ish hours worth of video footage and interviews into a concise, about 4-minute long video. So that was really, really difficult, but I'm really happy with how it turned out.
My name's Nathan Scott. I'm 69 years old. I've been in the nursery business for 43 years. It started out small and it grew gradually. That's what I do. Prior to that, I went to college. I have a degree in business from Tennessee Tech, and I graduated in 1976. I worked as a bank officer until 1980. And I quit that job and begun my career in nursery, very small, in the summer of 1980.
My name is Martin Scott, 35 years old, work at Hidden Mountain Nursery. I've been here for about 8 years. I'm the assistant manager here. My day-to-day activities vary from, you know, small menial tasks to, you know, doing more like managerial type things and here in the office. So it's, I wear many caps, doing many different things.
I grew up on a farm. My dad had a farm, small farm, 125-acre farm, and had cattle, and we did hay and cattle. And so I was had experience around cows and farm machinery, tractors, balers, all kinds of farm machinery. Agriculture work is very, very hard work. It is very non-glamorous. You're out in the heat. You're out there with the insects biting you. You're out there with the sweat.
And what's the hardest part of your job, people?
Over here, I don't think there's nothing hard for me over here in the North Bay.
At all?
No.
I remember my dad and my grandfather. Grandfather's name was Lincoln. And I remember a little bit older, probably 5 years old, being in the field, hateful. And I was in on the tractor with my dad. And I remember those spray bales, and I remember how hay smelled, I remember smelling. And I knew that very well. I could have been more than 5 years old. This is what I was doing. I was Farming's been very good, but it's been very hard. It's been easy. I will tell you, it's a hard time. And I said, don't go to think it's an easy life. That's why I'm here. Really, if it goes to sea, if we just want to play around with it and not be serious about it, we just have to play around with it. But if you actually want it to be proper and make some money, you're going to have to put it on.
There's easier ways to make money.
Okay.
So some challenges and difficulties I faced during my project. The number one difficulty I faced during my project was scheduling, just because it was so difficult to find a time that worked for everybody in my family and all of their employees at the actual nursery. And then traveling there was really difficult because I just like couldn't find the perfect time where everybody was together so that I could interview everyone at once. So I ended up having to go back multiple days in a row. And then lost footage. The camera kept cutting off during some of my interviews. I couldn't figure out it was because the batteries were dying or the storage was running out, but the camera did keep cutting off. So I lost about 30 minutes worth of footage that I did want to use in my final product, but I ended up having to work through that and just use the audio instead. And then it was really windy outside the multiple days I was interviewing, so the microphone didn't really like all the wind noise, and several of my interviews just ended up sounding like really windy, and I couldn't really use the audio from that. And then editing was my number one difficulty just because I'm really not good at editing, and it was a very steep learning curve, learning how to edit while simultaneously editing my final product without any practice beforehand. Here's what I learned. So number one, my family history and how the nursery generally operates. I had a general idea of how the nursery operates before I did this project, but it was really nice being able to learn in depth how my family business works and why they do what they do and how they do what they do, because I think it's such an important thing for more young people to learn how more agriculture jobs work. And then I learned how to film professional-ish footage. I'm not a professional video taker. I'm not good at taking videos, but it was really good for me to learn how to use this because I do think it's an important skill and I can use it in the future. Mm-hmm. And then respect for farmers and farm laborers. I learned a lot more respect for my grandparents and their employees both, because I think that being a farmer is a really underrated job. I think it's really difficult and really important for more people to respect farmers as a whole. I'd like to thank my parents for their support throughout this project and for my dad helping me with editing and helping me figure out all the kinks in my project, and my mom for actually taking me to the nursery. My grandparents, Nathan and Marcia Scott, for allowing me to come to the nursery and interview them, and my uncle, Martin Scott, all of them for taking time out of their busy schedule to meet with me and help me finish my project. Francisco Garcia for allowing me to pull him off of a tractor during his workday and interview him when he didn't really feel like it, but I really appreciated it. Mr. Simpson for being a great advisor, and all of you for listening. Thank you.
Good job, presenters. That was excellent. Julia, did you have an announcement?
Hi, everyone. I'm here to talk to y'all about something really quickly. As we know, I like to do equine stuff. And this Friday, a family friend and a close mentor of mine's barn burnt completely down. He left for lunch, like anyone else would during the workday. He left like it was completely normal. And when he returned, the whole thing was burnt down. Out of 43 horses, only 6 survived and 3 are in critical condition. His life's work was burnt down. This weekend and Monday, when he had to go back to work, he couldn't, unlike everyone else, because his life's work was gone. So we've set up a GoFundMe page to help find funding for him so he can get himself back on his feet, to help get money to help those horses who he's having to treat, who are in critical condition, because he has nothing. Saddles, equipment, stalls, medicine, nothing, because it's all gone. If you even think about donating, that's great. A prayer would work, or whatever you can do. It's the thought that matters, and I would really appreciate it. Thank you all.
Can you get the announcements up? Oh, thanks. Good morning, everyone. Great job, presenters. Mr. Greig, do you want to
just... Yeah, real quick, juniors, just forget we're leaving this Sunday. Sunday at 1 p.m. behind the big room. Juniors, Sunday class trip, leaving Monday. No, sorry. Sunday, we're getting back on Monday. Also, Walls of Jericho, if you're interested, I'll be in the back in chapel. Thank you.
Wow!
Web Worldwide Bake Sale, all three lunch periods from Thursday and Friday. Help support their annual Christmas project for the kids at Southside Elementary School in Shelbyville. Cash and Venmo, all proceeds go to the project. Grade meetings. Today we have ninth grade during E period, eighth grade during A period, ninth grade group B during F period, and then sixth grade during G period. That's everything.
Thank you. All right, please rise for the pledge.
Pledge allegiance.